just covered with crap. And I just want to know, what can we do to make it come back to the way it was? To the way when I came home from school where everyone, even the carp were swimming by spawning. And you couldn't catch them. You had to snag them if you wanted to. But what happened? What happened? I just want to know what happened.
All of that is tied to the warming of the water and the lack of oxygenation because of the warming. And our shorter winters and the shortening of the ice cover on the lake. I mean, there's a whole lot of factors that are actively engaged in what you're talking about. The fish are now catching viruses, and that's what's killing them. We have the same problem on Georgina. All of the sunfish are belly up right now.
Sunfish,
so we're finding hundreds and hundreds of sunfish that are now dying. And a lot of it is because of the temperature change that allows the viruses to thrive, and you know, everything is out of whack right now. So
eating.
Yeah, it's a larger picture than just us. You know, so that's a good thing. Other lakes in the country are struggling in the same way. We have to be very thoughtful about that as human beings. That we all have to play actively think about how we're living in the world. We can't stop that. We can't go out and throw ice in the lake to cool it off. But we can really start thinking very hard about what it is that we're doing on a day-by-day basis as an individual that's having an effect on the global warming. You can't, like, when you look out here, it looks kind of okay. But I'm telling you, if you go into the north and you go up into the Yukon or up into the Arctic, all of the water's gone.
Thank you.
Somebody pulled the plug and all of the water's gone.
See, the people... Sorry for interrupting, but a lot of the people that are sitting here haven't lived on a lake for 20 years.
Yeah.
And I have. And a lot of people haven't seen a lake. And I have. On my dock, you can see the water level drop. You can see the line.
Well, you know what we call that? We call that the presence of acid.
And that's
that you can look at that and see what was once there and is no longer there. The presence of acids. And it's a concept that I think we're all actively going to have to think about. You don't know it in the south, but in the north, you know, the caribou crossed over the calving ground.
Right.
A couple years ago, they lost 20,000 calves. They spontaneously aborted because they're stuck in the tundra because it's melting. So it's warming, and we all have to really think about that.
Yeah, great answer, Cynthia, and I totally agree with it, but I wanted to address the question about what happened. And the relationship between, Cynthia was talking about oxygen in the water and phosphorus. There's a relationship. So when you change the watershed, and we all have to have fingers pointed at ourselves. It's not one specific industry or business or development or farming. It's not one, it's all of us. When you change the watershed, what happens is more phosphorus goes into the lake. And we know that up until a number of years ago, the lake on average was getting around 100 metric tons of phosphorus per year going into the lake.
Right.
And we knew that to have a healthy lake, that figure needed to go way down. So what happens when you get a lot of phosphorus in the lake is it impacts the oxygen that Cynthia was talking about. And many years ago when we started looking at Kuching and Simcoe, the dissolved oxygen in the lake was around 1.9 milliliters. And cold water fish, the ones that you talk about that are dying, cold water fish need high levels of oxygen in between 5 to 7 milliliters of dissolved oxygen to live properly. So, we've been working hard, and when I say we, I mean everybody. The municipalities, the federal government, the First Nations people, all the partners have been working hard to get that phosphorus level down. It's now somewhere in around 72 metric tons per year, and the dissolved oxygen is somewhere around 4.9 milliliters. Still not good enough for the cold water fish. And the provincial...
Not even close.
Not even close. You're absolutely right.
And I live right across from the Ontario, where they clean the water, for crying out loud, right by the Kuching Beach.
Right. So the target now, the province came out with a new target in 2008-2009. They want to take the phosphorus load on average down to 44 tons per year from the current 70. Like, big, big, big change. And the dissolved oxygen up to 7 milligrams per liter so that the cold water fish can live. Because right now, much of it's a stocked fishery. It's not a naturally reproducing fishery.
Yep.
So that's part of the explanation, and this has been happening for years and years and years.
Just some thoughts on the water level issue is that we have the same amount of fresh water on Earth as we did when the dinosaurs were here, but it's just moving around the world. And I have some friends traveling in Australia when they're having floods where they've never seen so much water. So some of our water is now, that our climate is changing.
We need it back.
We need to bring it back. We need it. This is where, again, great, taking good care of the water that you use and collecting it from the sky. And these technologies are available. And
that's the point of this festival, right, sir? That's the reason why we have this.
Absolutely.
Well, I've swum in this lake for a number of years myself, probably a little over 50. And so I am sort of familiar with it as well. And it's not the same lake that it was 50 years ago, not in any stretch. And even childhood visions, aside, the
I used to be able to do a backflip off my dock.
Well, it's funny when you talk about water levels, because the reality is in Lake Simcoe, the water levels are controlled. We have a trench system where they can, let water out to adjust the level. That's the reality of it. You want to see a real change, you don't have to go as far as the Arctic. You could go over to Lake Huron, where the shorelines are 100 to 200 to even 300 feet out from where they were 20 years ago. That is, to me, the real canary in the coal mine of what's happening with our water systems. We're spoiled, and most people don't see it, because you look out and you see what appears to be a pristine lake. Our entire ecosystems are under a huge amount of stress right now.
Attack. And if you even go to Algonquin Park, I don't know, I'm sure that everyone here, if you're Canadian, you've been to Algonquin Park at least once in your life. If you go there now, I mean,
it's sad.
It's sad, exactly.
Very sad.
I don't know who said that, but it is sad. It's really, really sad. Because when I was there, when I was 6 years old, and like I said, I'm 30 years old, I'm a teacher now. When I went there, when I was 6 years old, it was just fantasy land, And now going there, it's just a...
want to cry.
Anyways, there's an issue there, too. I've been going to Cedar Lake, a very interior lake. I've been going there for 20 years with my family to this
lake. Yeah, same with us.
And you're seeing algae growing in. You're seeing
gross.
There's only, the 20 horsepower limit, and hardly any boats. It's quite remote.
That's the thing, is there's not very many boats.
It's everywhere. It's not just in developed areas.
Thank you, guys. I appreciate it.
Thanks for your question. Great question.
Cheers.
Anybody else on Lake Simcoe? Any particular concerns, questions, ideas you'd like to bring forward to the panel? Before we move on to the next topic, because I'm not that familiar, and this just made me wonder, maybe Gail or Cynthia or someone. Oh, sorry, we do have another question. Yes. Go ahead.
No, I've just been listening to this, and I'm just wondering, the water from the road, where's the wastewater from Barrie? Does it go directly into the lake? Is it treated?
So the stormwater goes straight in. Uh-huh. Wastewater gets treated
water,
as the butane.
Okay. I mean stormwater then.
Yes.
Sorry.
Yeah.
I don't mean to butt in. So then the salt, the oil that drips off of every car that drives,
it all goes
into
in.
The lake.
As it does everywhere around the province.
I'm not saying that, but I'm saying that is one of the big problems with the lake here right
it's
now.
It's probably the biggest one.
And I'm not saying it's just Barrie.
Yeah.
And I live out in a farming area, and I know that fertilizer and manures run into the streams, and they go into the lake. So, you hear where you're spending $70 million to clean this up and clean that up, but it's not doing anything until you get to some of these other problems. That's just my opinion, my observation.
Well, fair enough, but it is, and as Gail actually just rhymed off, it is actually having an impact. The phosphorus levels have decreased, and the oxygen levels have increased, which is all going in the right direction. So it actually has had an impact, the spending and all the projects that have been done. And we know that because we measure it. But you're right, sir. The agricultural runoff, the fertilizer, which in many cases has an extremely high phosphorus content, you talk about phosphorus into the lake, when you're washing phosphorus fertilizers right into the lake, that's about as bad as it gets. When it comes to the stormwater runoff, though, absolutely, there is a huge amount of work to do everywhere. But we here in the Lake Simcoe watershed it's a more urgent issue because of the condition of the lake itself. And, you know, the filtration that can occur naturally can be extremely effective.
Yes.
So that's why naturalizing the creek beds actually does make a difference and why those projects have been prioritized. Gail may want to speak to this, but when the Conservation Authority did a strategy to say, what are the biggest wins in terms of the biggest bang for the buck? You're going to go out and spend money trying to clean up the lake and reduce what's getting washed in. Where can you make the biggest difference? Those stormwater projects were high on the list.
We didn't start putting stormwater ponds in into being until later on, I would say in the 70s, for water quality control purposes. So now when there's a development, there's new technologies that we're testing with the federal government money, and all development is controlled through storm water quality and quantity. Problem is, as the mayor said, is that we now have to go back and retrofit all those stormwater ponds in the entire watershed. And you can imagine how many there are with all the development we've got here. We have to go back and retrofit the ones that weren't set up for water quality purposes. So it's a big project. And, you know, I just want to say again, it took years for Lake Simcoe to get into the shape that it's in, and it's going to take us years to fix the problem as well. But we are making progress.
Why is it that in Canada, the U.S. is much more normal for everyone to have a car?
You can't grow coffee here, you can't grow bananas here, but there's no reason that Canada needs to be a net importer of things like apples.
That's right.
You know, and
we've got them in our backyard.
The food that's being produced in South America, in Asia, and shipped here, the cost of the petroleum to produce that, the fertilizers, the harvesting, the shipping, is just horrendous. We need to look more at using local products, like local food, to reduce our dependency on oil.
Great.
Great. All right, sir. Step forward, please.
I would just like to know, hydro is not doing an awful lot as far as wind power and solar panels versus trying to build maybe more nuclear plants and still burning oil and coal. So why would they put more solar panels around in the areas where they have their own towers that the land is already clear? There's no reason not to.
Great question. And here's your $20 for asking it, because yesterday we unveiled the first solar array on the roof of the Powerstream building here on Patterson Road. What your local company, so there's, as usual with these things, there's multiple layers of government involved and different levels doing different things. What the local distribution companies, which is Powerstream, that used to be Berry Hydro, we merged with Powerstream. What Powerstream is doing is leasing big flat rooftops in our service area, Markham, Vaughan, and Berry, and installing solar panels. The first project is on at 55 Patterson Road, which is the Berry Hydro office building. That array went live a few weeks ago, and we actually had to kick off yesterday, or the day before. It generates 1.4 megawatts. It's enough when it's really going to fund 80, or at least supply power for 80% of that building itself, and we hope to get that to 100%, so the building itself, the big office building, is totally off the grid. So what Powerstream is doing is bidding on contracts that are let by the provincial government under what's called the feed-in tariff program, where they pay a premium for renewables, solar energy and wind energy. And it's not just Powerstream, it's all, there's lots of little solar companies, little and big wind companies that are doing this across the province. So